Arpit, and now welcome to the second part of Yojana for the month of April 2024. In the previous video, we covered two topics. First was our ecosystem, in which we saw several physical features of our country, starting from the Himalayas. Then we talked about the plains, we talked about the Thar Desert, we talked about the Central Highlands, that is the Peninsular Plateau. We also talked about the islands, that is Andaman Nicobar Island and the Lakshadweep Islands. And we came to know about a lot of facts about these places. Second topic was Western Ghats. We, you know, narrowed down our focus on one of the physical features of our country, that is Western Ghats. And, you know, in this particular topic, we saw that, you know, how rich the biodiversity of Western Ghats is. Why it is so rich? Because of the monsoonal winds, when they shed their monsoons. The trees over there or forest over here are evergreen forests. Lot of endemic species are found over here. The endemism rate is too high. And this ecosystem is also fragile. Fragile because of any human activities like construction and all, or diversion of forest land towards other activities, disturbs this ecosystem a lot. So measures have to be taken for conservation in this particular ecosystem, which is a biodiversity hotspot, which is a UNESCO World Heritage Site also. So we discussed all of that. Now in this particular video, we're going to talk about the soil ecosystem. Soil ecosystem, soil where, you know, the crops grow, where the trees grow. It is one of the basic essential features of our ecosystem. If soil would not have been there, life would not have been there. And that ecosystem in and around soil comprises of living as well as non-living creatures. Biotic means living, and abiotic means non-living features are very much intrinsic to the soil ecosystem. And both of these features, means biotic and abiotic, are responsible for good soil health. Then in the second topic, which we will be covering here, is sacred groves. In sacred groves, as the name suggests, groves are small forests kind of, and the sacred word which we are using is basically people conserve these small forests primarily for, I would say, religious purposes, or they have certain traditional sentiments attached to these small forests. And at times these small forests, they have certain economic benefits attached with it. That is why they conserve these forests. And by conserving these sacred groves, obviously, they are contributing to the green cover of the country. So this is what we need to understand in these two topics. So let's get started with the first topic, that is the soil ecosystem. It is basically a remarkable and complex network of organisms and abiotic factors. Now here, organisms are biotic, and abiotic factors means non-living factors, and how they interact with each other actually testifies this health of the soil ecosystem. It supports a diverse array of life forms, playing a critical role in sustaining terrestrial ecosystems and human societies. Now, components of soil ecosystem. The first component is physical environment. Physical environment means the texture of the soil, the structure and moisture content in the soil. Texture and, I would say, structure means how loosely, I would say, packed it is, how dense it is, or how loosely packed it is, what color it is. It can be red soil, black soil, alluvial soil. It all depends on that. And depending on these features, you know, this soil quality comes out to be playing into picture. These factors influence the distribution and behavior of organisms within the soil profile. Next component which are found in soil is organic matter. Organic matter means, you know, trees are there. So when the leaves shed from the trees, because deciduous forest is all about this. So when the trees shed their leaves, those are there falling on the ground. Shrubs and all are there on the ground. Fruits also fall on the ground from the trees. All this is organic matter. This decomposes and acts like, I would say, manure for the trees over there. So other, apart from organic matter, microbes like fungi and earthworms are also there, which help in, you know, consuming this organic matter and converting it into a kind of manure for the trees over there. Microorganisms, they are found a lot in the soil. Bacteria, fungi, protozoa, virus, etc., etc. This is very, very important. The microbes are very, or microorganisms are very, very important because they break down organic matter, fix nitrogen, and contribute to the formation of soil aggregates. Next is macroorganisms. Micro to be blunt. Macro. Larger organisms, including earthworms, insects, nematodes, and small mammals that inhabit soil and play various roles in nutrient cycling, soil aeration, and soil structure formation. Their activities influence soil fertility and ecosystem functioning. When we talk about plant roots, they exudate fuel microbial activity and contribute to soil organic matter, shaping soil microbial communities and nutrient cycling processes. So these roots are also very much important because movement of water up and down happens through the roots. Absorption of minerals happens through the roots. Absorption of nutrients happens through the roots. So this is very much important. If the roots absorb a lot of water, then the soil moisture will be down. That is not required. Next is functions of soil ecosystem. How the soil ecosystem functions. First is nutrient cycling. Now, soil organisms decompose organic matter, like, you know, the microbes and all over there, releasing nutrients such as nitrogen, phosphorus, and potassium into the soil. These nutrients are then taken up by plants, fueling growth and productivity. So, let's suppose the leaves fall down, the microbes act upon it, decompose it, then after decomposing it, various nutrients such as nitrogen, phosphorus, and potassium are released, which is important for the soil. Soil health will improve. Then the trees will grow further. Leaves will come in the next season again. They will fall down again. And then the same cycle will be repeated. That is called as nutrient cycling. Decomposition. Microorganisms and detritivores break down the organic matter, recycling nutrients and returning them to the soil. Decomposition processes contribute to soil fertility and organic matter accumulation. So decomposition is done by microbes only. So nothing, I would say, new in that. Soil formation. Through weathering and biological processes, soil develops over time from parent material. So this is basically weathering happens, the wind blows, the top layer is, you know, broken, biological processes like microbes, they undergo, you know, that kind of breakdowns and all. Then soil is generated. Water regulation. Soil acts as a reservoir for water, storing and releasing it slowly over time. Soil influences water infiltration, retention, and drainage, affecting plant growth, groundwater recharge, and flood mitigation. So it is helpful in water regulation also. If the soil health is not there, if the soil is not able to retain moisture or it is not able to retain water, then obviously water will flow, leaving that particular area under distress. And last is habitat support. Soil provides a habitat for a vast array of organisms ranging from microscopic bacteria to larger mammals. So this is obviously habitat support is dependent upon the health of the soil. Next topic is sacred groves. Groves, as the name suggests, are small forest areas protected by local people. And generally, through religious beliefs, traditional sentiments, and taboos, and are reserves of many endangered species. That is why the word sacred is given to them. These are popularly called living biological heritage sites because of rich diversity present in them. Now, when these forests, small forests are maintained, they are not only maintaining the trees over there or shrubs over there. As we read in the last topic or previous topic, soil health, a lot of microbes will also thrive over there. Macroorganisms will also be thriving over there. You know, a whole lot of biodiversity will be developed in that region. Soil will be able to retain moisture. So in that region, you know, that will be water retention will be there and scarcity of water will not happen. Now it has been estimated that the total number of groves in India is more than 1.5 lakh. However, more than 14,000 groves have been counted in different states. They have different local names in rural and tribal areas. So, this local names have to be known. First is in Sikkim. They are popularly known as Gumpas. Kavu in Kerala, Oran in Rajasthan, and Andhra Pradesh and Telangana, it is popularly known as Pavitra Vanalu, Rakshita Vanalu, or Devata Vanalu. So these are the names given to sacred groves in different parts of the country. And it is like this. Types of sacred groves. Basically, there are multiple types of sacred groves. Like first is temple gardens. These gardens are associated with temples since it is a place of worship. It is considered as a place of worship. So it is like this. So a few months ago, I went to this holy city, Vrindavan. Now in Vrindavan, there is one such sacred grove. It is named as Nidhivan. So if any one of you gets a chance to go to Vrindavan, so do visit that sacred grove, Nidhivan. They have conserved the forest. The trees are short-heighted trees. It is believed by the people that, you know, all these trees, they turn into gopis during the night, and Krishnaji comes, does the Leela over there. And there's a temple there in the middle of that, you know, sacred grove. And, you know, the Panditji keeps paan over there and sets the bed and all over there nicely. And at 4 o'clock in the morning, you know, you get the prasad of the chewed paan, chabe hue paan ka prasad milta. It is believed that Krishnaji came and ate that. So it is like this. And, you know, don't dare to go and see the proceedings during the night time, because, you know, those people who have tried it, multiple foreigners have tried it, they have lost their lives. It is believed in this way, you know. So, but during the daytime you can go. A lot of monkeys are there. So they've made now tunnels to go inside that, but you know, from the tunnels you'll be able to see the sacred grove maintained over there. So that is basically a temple garden, Nidhivan. Traditional gardens, these are the places where folk deities reside. They often contain a rich diversity of plant and animal life. Religious gardens, again, like, you know, temple gardens only, these are associated with Hinduism, Buddhism, Jainism, Islam, and Sikhism. Traditionally, these are protected by local communities through religious beliefs and customs rather than through formal government law. Island groves can be categorized based on the habitat type, like mangroves island, coastal reverie areas in Andhra Pradesh. They have different types of, I would say, forests over there. The small islands, then, you know, the types of trees over there can be categorized like this. Then burial, cremation, memorial groves. They are associated with burial places. These are seen as places of reverence for the deceased and are believed to be inhabited by the spirits of ancestors. So these are the types of sacred groves which are prevalent in our country. Now, significance of sacred groves, first and most important significance is that, you know, ecosystem preservation is there. Although a small area, but yes, the biodiversity increases in that area. The soil health is increased in that area because out of religious reason or out of traditional heritage reasons, these are protected. Then, custodians of traditional knowledge. A lot of traditional knowledge is there in those, I would say, sacred groves. And local communities know about those things. Maybe some medicinal plants are there in those sacred groves. And those medicinal plants may be of immense significance to those local communities who are conserving it. So that is also an importance of these sacred groves. Then custodians of biodiversity. Biodiversity is maintained, ecology or biodiversity linked they are. Cultural preservers. A lot of cultural heritage is preserved. We get to know a lot of practices of conservation. We get to know a lot of, I would say, usage of various trees or shrubs which are grown over there. So those are cultural preservers as well. And definitely environmental benefits we have from these sacred groves. So these sacred groves should not be ignored, I would say. The more number of sacred groves will be there, the better preservation of our, I would say, biodiversity can be done, or ecosystems can be done. Along with it, preservation of our cultural values can also be done. So it is like, you know, ek teer se do nishane. So it has double benefits. Now, when it comes to the challenges, first challenge is habitat loss. Habitat loss simply means habitat is basically the home to those trees, the home to those microorganisms, macroorganisms which are surviving in the sacred groves. But you know, population is increasing, the demand for land is increasing, diversion of land is happening for more and more commercial purposes. So, all this leads to habitat loss. And this is one such challenge in the sacred groves. Climate change is another challenge. So we've talked enough about climate change. And, you know, obviously, climate change leads to increased temperatures. Increased temperatures lead to reduced soil moistures. Reduced soil moistures lead to, I would say, negative impacts on the overall soil ecosystem or that entire, groves ecosystem. So it has, I would say, drastic impact because suddenly rainfalls are there and high intensity rains are there, or at times no rainfall is there. There are long periods without rains. So all these are impacting the sacred groves. Invasive alien species. Invasive alien species, alien means species means those kind of species, whether of flora or fauna, which have been introduced in an area where they do not belong to. They've come from outside. And when they come from outside, they start causing destructions. They start consuming or they start harming the local ecosystem. So that can be introduced either by the humans, these invasive alien species, or can be introduced naturally also. You know, factors like wind and all, they are responsible for carrying such kind of alien species. These alien species can be of flora or fauna, any. Then exploitation of resources. Now in some cases, local communities collect large amounts of firewood, medicinal plants or other resources. And when this, you know, collection or this exploitation increases, surpasses the limit, then, you know, things do not go in the right direction. The ecosystem's balance gets disturbed and the deterioration of that ecosystem starts. So that has to be, you know, taken care of. Now, to conclude on this particular, I would say, sacred groves, these are legally protected under Wildlife Conservation Amendment Act 2002 as community reserves. And they are one of the best examples for community conservation and also a unique source of in-situ conservation. In-situ means everything inside happens, nothing as such from outside is taken. But due to rapid urbanization, cultural migration, anthropogenic pressure, global warming and climate change, the forest and their ecology and the floral, you know, composition, it is getting disturbed, it is getting altered. And, you know, this is something which is not good. There is therefore an urgent need basically to promote and undertake more and more conservation efforts or measures for these sacred groves. Because, you know, these small forests can play a very, very important role, especially in cities like Bengaluru, where water scarcity is there. But these small groves, if they are conserved well in, you know, distant spaces, then they will help in better conserving the water, holding the water, because when, you know, trees are there, forests are there, the water retention increases. This will take, you know, a lot of efforts, no doubt about that fact, and it will take a bit of time also. All we need is the right intention to do it. Once we are there on track, things will start giving the results. I think Anna Hazare did one such thing in Maharashtra and things turned around for the people in that region. So we need to do things in this direction. And with this, we come to an end of this particular segment. I will be meeting you for the third part now and we will be discussing the remaining topics over there. Till then, you guys very well know what to do. Keep studying, keep reading, keep writing, keep watching the videos and keep revising. Namaste. Jai Hind.